here, it would be later ministry, stand down in the middle of your car. I can't trust a memory. I just got to tell you, you know, and I might start talk for an hour, and I make your keys angry. But I forgot to check with him, but I would like to be presumptuous enough to make it, give notice. I reminded you people that in our church today, that there's one big change, an important one, that we invite people, we're all God's children. And when time comes for Holy Communion, if there's anyone among you who is not an Anglican, if you're a baptized, you're a Christian, you're God, one of God's children, and if you wish so desire, you're welcome to come and share it in the altar and to receive the very life. Well, I want to thank you, Rector. This is an unexpected pleasure to be here today. We planned this in December, my friend Dr. Bennett and I come down here, and he's an old family, he was a family doctor, he was our parishioner friend, and I told him, he asked him, what are you going to do this summer? I said, well, I won't go down to where I started, all started. He said, I'm going to come with you. I said, good. So here we are. And so we contacted her and he said, go to church. I'll be in Marystown this morning, so we go to church. Oh, we went here. I see better. But then I was hoping he'd invite me to take part. And he ended up by saying, would you like to preach? Oh, yes. I do. It all began here. And being able to commemorate with you your past is a very special thing. And it's, for me, especially, you know, my ministry began here 63 years ago, last month. And so it's such a delight. I came, a young fellow, with lots of enthusiasm. I was going to set the world on fire. Because you like that, you come out of university, you learn your college, and you want to, you really believe you're going to make a change. And God willing, in my life I've made some, I don't know what changed, but things are good. God's only God knows. But all I know is you had the vim that you need, and the enthusiasm of youth to get up and do. And I got up and did, just by ability and understanding. And for which I give God thanks. I came with a bit of school, with book learning, of course, in our day, 4 years without training time, but I was green. I knew nothing about ministry, and I certainly did not have any experience in growing up in a parish where I'd got to get here, and I didn't know until I got here. Matter of fact, I only knew about half an hour before I got off the old SS Springdale, I was coming to a little island. Someone told me, so I said, is it? Yes. And then we had to drop anchor and wait, you couldn't get in the harbor. That was another surprise. And then when I got here, I soon learned, well, I went down 100 miles over and took from Henley Harbor to Sea Islands. Well, I don't know, we know the days are probably 150 miles. I don't know. And all the 15 or 16 places, you might want to choose your families there. Yeah. But you got to preach, you got to teach, you got to try to be, you know, minister. So it's kind of overwhelming. I did not want to do it, but I was going to learn by grace of God. So that was what I was looking at. And I can see myself now coming down, getting off the boat, after, you know, sitting on the mailboxes coming ashore, and coming ashore there behind the Abraham Puck's house, I believe, a walk up the trail, two suitcases, and, you know, all my worldly goods in them two suitcases. I said, look, the truth of that. A few articles of clothing and a few books, and that was precious. And off I started. And I believe it was the ministry began in the bank. Now, even before I could get the first Sunday service here, I got word that the call was on its way from St. Anthony. And there was a young man, 21 years of age, a guy from Square Islands, and I was expected and invited to go down to the funeral. Okay, so I jumped on the car. I get the clothes together, I jump on and go to Square Islands for my first service in the parish. I was at the funeral. So it was a very bad, very sad thing. But I want to tell you that my coming here, I learned things that enriched my whole ministry. They say I had a very, you know, with my by the wonderful way. And she was a great support. She did more. I always said she worked harder than I did. We did more. And the women's work from here to Vancouver. She was involved in the National Church, women, everything in between. But I tell you, I learned things that was, you know, my old ministry was part of me. I was reached by it. That is why it's such a delight to be coming and share with you. Now, you heard the readings. Now, I have to tell you in the beginning, I don't want to preach on those readings today. I understood. I didn't ask the Reverend, as they could say, anything, but I assume a commemoration service means you're looking back at the past, and in a parish life with particular importance and pride and thanksgiving to those men and women who in their life and examples, the teaching, and people you knew, people already, sometimes you already knew it all, but they did things and helped make you what you are today. And now we say, we thank God for them, because they help determine what we have become. That's how I understand it. And I share with you in that act of thanksgiving. And the second thing is, rededication to what it's all about, the real essence of life. And I won't have much time to talk about you, but I'll say something. A little tiny bit, in due course. So what I want to do, I have a theme, and my theme is, remember, and I want to remember people, names of people in some instances. I might have asked some of you, who am I talking about? But remembering what they did, I know, for Jim Reed, and also for the parish, we call it the mission of Battle Harbor. Well, as I said, my ministry started with that little shock. So we went down to Square Islands. Well, I can't even remember now if it was one room school doing service or we're not. I'm not sure, certain. And I discovered that the boy who died was Mr. and Mrs. Kipnock's son, Kippenhook. That's who will be looking after me all the time I was here. I stayed with them. So we had the service. But then, firstly, we'll get in the boat. Part of Charlottetown, where the cemetery was. So you sit beside the court for a couple hours, I don't know how long. And the sun was shining, I know that. It was a beautiful day. But by the time you get up there and do all you need to get back, it was dark. Now then, the question for me was, God, I'm back home now, and I'm on the way, I want to get back home, get started. But how do I get back to Battle Harbor? Well, sir, the Northern Ranger would come and maybe tomorrow, maybe the next day. Yeah, sure. You get right back on it. Okay. Well, so that's the beginning of learning that when you come to Labrador, like many places still do from that in the early years of my ministry, you had a general plan. The folks in Labrador, the best man plans the most men to walk the ride. And you decided Mother Nature decided if you were going to get or not. The weather, you had no control over the weather. No man did. So sometimes you just waited and you waited. And so that was the first thing I learned, was try to be patient. And I was an impatient young man. I've been a slow learner all my life, but I'm in that area. I don't know if I've learned it yet, darling. But at the same time, Square Islands at that time, and I don't know, probably 10, 12 dozen houses. There's people, I don't think there was not very many, very few. And I know, and some of them were, there's two, and then at that time, I know the Pentecostal church was beginning to get started. Ben Powell was there, and he was starting to bring Charlottetown into existence. And there's two or three people, and I know there's one old fellow there, old Mr. Campbell, I think they came from Scotland, I think he was Scotch Presbyterian starting off. But I decided, well, boy, you got to do something to justify your existence. So I decided to go knock on doors and talk, I pray ministry is people. And that was the beginning of ministry for me. I don't care what the religion was, I didn't know. But I visited them. And I did where the learning began. Because that became, I think you can ask Dr. Doug Bennett, he'll tell you that. The Gander was a big parish, and I tell you. And over the years, here in other parishes, I think literally I knocked on thousands of doors. I saw that as an important part of my ministry, even though I reached a point where there was a lot of administration and meetings all over creation. But there always had to be a time for visiting and talking to people one-on-one. Because that's where the essence of our faith is built on, I believe, relationships. Well, so I learned about having to be patient, and I learned the importance. Looking at the people, Here's what I learned at first experience with their generosity, their kindness, and hospitality. Because I've been around to those places, and it happens over the next 3 or 4 years, whatever it was, you know, summer and winter, down team, travel this winter, boats and summer. But you know, come in, sir. And very long, I'd like to have a cup of tea. Okay. And you went to a place in houses, they often didn't have much in some of those places down the shore that they were. But you got there by April month after a long winter, I can tell you, there were kind times you could get stormbound and there wasn't too much around the table. But it was always, what we got, so you're welcome to. So you, and in some places you spread your sleeping bag on the kitchen floor, and they went to bed you got in the morning, and I went for soup, but anyway, you basically call your hand, and you go and beat the place, beat the spot in the snow. You stick your hand in case the dogs are coming. So you're better part of learning experience. Yes, right? I just want to, so anyway, I want to be able to share a few things with you, which will expand upon, in some degree, these experiences. And I hope that I see Jesus Christ at work, and the God and the Spirit of God at work in it, and I hope you will too. Because it's not about Jim Reed. Don't misunderstand me. We're talking about the Spirit of God at work in us and through us. So, the first thing, I guess, I want to vote. That's that very first time I stand for chair in Square Islands. I wait a couple of days. I don't know how long I waited now. I said, well, you got to vote, Jim. Get around, do your work. You can't depend and expect men to leave their fishing boats. And the midst of the fishing can't love you. Now, they did that first year. I had no boat, but I had to wait until they could do it. And sometimes I just had to wait an extra day or so. So I leave here to go down the coast. I could be gone 3 weeks before I got back, and the summers are short. So I got the boat that arranged for late that fall. Next spring she came down from Flower Stove area, made knots and then put the engine aboard, got on, and I went up the bay, got it. She didn't work really good. And the engine was a Norwegian, I think, called Kelvin, 15 horsepower, I know, and a spark plug engine. And I kicked that in, I figured she could go to work. So they put her together, and they go, and I got her up to Mary's Harbor. You were naked with the new boats, no engines. So you got her tuned from a point to an hour. So I was ready to go, and I waited. Well, but next summer, or next spring, well, that fall, then I took her up the bay, and for securing the winter, late fall. Well, then early next spring, we got fit before you could put back over here, with Joe Rumble and John Ackerman. They said, well, we'd nice to deck her over, sir. Yes, why, wonderful. So I don't know what we got in the money. I don't know, maybe I got somebody from St. Thomas and John's, I suspect. And maybe there's nobody in no cost. I can't remember giving the boys the money to do the job, but honest, sir. And anyway, they decked her over, and that was in paradise. That's the honest truth. Which is wonderful. I haven't got time to tell you all the wonderful experiences I had. Some of them were some crazy. You're interesting. One of the important things for me having a boat, I believe that if I had a boat, I could traditionally, the clergyman made 2 visits down north in the summer, but only 1 in the winter donkey. Well, I never had much control over the winter. But I feel in winter and summers, I could do something with that. I wanted to do 3, at least. And I did. And around the area, but I could do more than that, of course, you see. And so I haven't got time to tell you very many, but I just mentioned one of those down the north. It stands out because of what happened. I went down in the fall, and now, you're from James Island, Sea Islands. Well, it's Sea Lord. When I got there, yeah, there was in commission in those days. I didn't come with trips down to battle, you know, spot on to do a service for River Avatar. I don't know if it was much of a hire, it was with my own enjoyment. But when I got there, this family, I think his name was Ed, but not certain. Hopkins, if there's any Hopkins there? Well, okay, thank you. Got my memory. Let me go. And his wife was sick. And she was in bed. She needed a doctor. And the men had their ship, they had their little boats all up for the winter, you know, secured. And they didn't know, you know, communications were like in those days, where the known boat was on its way, they didn't know where. But I don't know, back a bit, it was what they called women's troubles, losing blood, I don't know. I didn't know. He could tell you more than that, I know. But she needed a doctor. Well, I said, sure, I got a nice boat here. I can take you a car for it, you know, if you want to. But somebody got to go up and show me the way. Okay, so they stowed her boat, got her down to the cubby, you know, because a little stove in it. Nice. And we went on. So anyway, it must have been 10 or 11 o'clock at night, or 9 or 10 anyway. I know we're steaming in Savage Bay, it seemed like we're hours in there. And it had to come up and show us the way past the harbor. So, and by the time we got over to the wharf alongside the hospital, my God, people were coming around shore. Nothing, you know, and there was one fellow, Mama, I know a little bit, some of you might remember, you know, but your parents would remember, you used to come here sometimes, Roy Rousel, welfare officer, they called it in those days. And when the travel came to see what was going on, I said, well, there's a little engine, a little boat going an hour a year. Boy, he looks at me and says, what in the name of God are you doing down here this time of year, Natalie? I said, well, where are you going to stay tonight? I said, I don't know, I got a cabin's nice there. Not likely. So I had to come and rest a couple of days, and back, okay. But I felt, you know, I didn't know that until next winter, and the woman got along, everything worked out fine. You know, but I felt justified in making that, because people told me around here, some of them, especially Stan, perhaps, Stan was, you know, that's not been on time. Stan was not a brave fellow around boats, that wasn't his life. He was up at the Marconi station, but he shared a record with me. He was going after, he was bored. I don't know, that worked out. The church and the ring for our diocese, I never saw anybody. And by the way, I don't know if he had a baby ring. I don't know. I have no idea. But anyway, the Stan thought I was kind of foolish, stupid. But now he wouldn't die, you know. But he let me know he didn't think he was very silly. He thought a bit silly. But I always didn't listen well. Well, that's I'll leave the business for now. And a brief note on winter time travel. Well, there's nothing exciting about winter time travel. Dog teams. When I talk about we like Labrador to some church groups some years ago, to the women's group in St. Thomas's Church of St. John's and the women's group at the cathedral, because both of those churches, you see, they're the women's association who used to raise money to assist those two missions, you see. And I used to be phone them to write them sometimes rather by some special meeting. They would help finance something. And that's how not just me, but the church in those days. And so I talked to them. Top down team travel. My name sounds so exciting, wonderful. But my response to them was quite simple. Well, my darlings, if you had to sit on the back of the car for 4 or 5 hours, look at the rear end of dogs, you wouldn't find it very romantic. I discovered from experience that the way you got along, you survived it. And reason well. I went up to Flowers Cove the first fall. The bishop was going to take me out of it, you see, and I didn't want to leave. So I wrote him a letter and said, well, thank you, sir, but I would really like to stay. Because I was enjoying it. And he said, okay, on one condition, you've got to go up Flowers Cove and make the communion, because I was only a deacon, and before winter sets in. Well, okay, I'll do that. But it took me 10 days in those days. Me there, go to Flowers Cove, have my communion on Sunday there, get back. I was 10 or 12 days. And when I was there, he took me over to visit the Rhythmical Association doctor. I went around to the hospital to visit sick with him. And there was a couple of English nurses there, and they took pity on that poor little Newfoundlander, little small fellow going down that rough Labrador in the winter time. And so they gave me a beautiful sleeping bed, oiler sleeping bed, light as a feather. And I loved that around the parish all the time I was there. But they also gave me a beautiful pair of moccasins made up. Remember those days, the beautiful moccasin skins and the beautiful stuff on the leggings, you know, it looks a pretty picture. And they gave me them for travel. Well, my God, I could go and run like a rabbit. That's a lace of feather on you. And that's how I learned that there's a 20-mile trip on Dog Team. All you folks know that. You ain't know, I probably run the tenement. And I could run there. Which reminds me. The first trip to Henley Harbour, I stayed with Evanstone and Murphy. And they all looked after me so well. And next door neighbour was William Endring. his brother, William Henry, came in to visit the new parish, see the new parish, and sized him up. Looked at me. Oh, he said, "Parson, we're going to lick you." "Yes." "Oh, yes," he said. "You're only small and good. You won't be hard to look around like the dog team."
But
it was some fun times. The crowd, I remember, you see, there was three Rumble brothers. There was Bill, Charles, and one more, I can't remember his name, the old man was Charlie. And they used to play checkers. And every once in a while, they'd invite me up for a game of checkers. Now, I never won a game. And I think they used to take great delight like beat that young person. But it was nice. So then I just tried, there was no programming in those days very much, and I was always conscious of getting some younger people, and there must be something you can do, you know, before you start to travel. I remember, so when I was a young man going to finish down to school, and after I spent 3.5 years in Gander during the war, working aircraft, the ferry command, I thought I was a mechanic, went back home, finished my schooling. Then I got involved with the high school youngsters, the somebody put off an old West Southern comedy, another concert that I played called The Ready Made Family. So I had a copy of that, and I changed some words of that, and got a crowd together with the nurse, Stedman, and Chester Rumble, and I think his sister, and there's a girl worked in the hospital, by the time he employed from Chip Gates and Charles, who worked in the hospital, Miss Button, the nurse, the chef, whatever, and a few others, we put it off, and it made a great time. It was cool, enjoy. But anyway, get back some church. I got to tell you about George's Cove. I'll pick on that, I could tell you some others, but George's Cove, at Sadness and Gladness, it enlightened people, some people there. Before I went there, one family, there was a teacher from Rosal Cove or somewhere, and he went up for a Sunday afternoon, Randy, I think he used to call it, going out for a dog keeper, a trip. And we stayed, and the man in the house said, yes, you can take the dog over right, over right. And he took his three children. You might have heard the story more than I know. And he went out, and he left the camp point, but he went in, and some bit of, you know, a few tuckaboards there, and I guess he was calling to get rid of some water. So he left them and ran around for a bit. And while he was gone, he heard a noise, and the dogs had pounced on the three little children, and they were dead. And I think, I can cry when it now. The saddest thing to my life is visit that woman. And that was 2 or 3 years after it happened. She never smiled. How could she? The loss of three children. It was, oh my God, I can't bear it now. But anyway, that was just, but now there were other things. And that's not really, I really didn't tell you about that. George's Cove, I think an old lady, old Mrs., I don't know if she's Mr. or Mrs., but I don't know if she's spinster or widow, Mrs. Burton, and she has a little house, not a lot of things, and she had a man, his wife, and it could be her son, I don't even know that. All I know is I prepared the young man, the man's wife, and two or three teenage children for their confirmation. I got a picture of them all dressed in white, you know, and the confirmation time, as used to be in those days. And but you know, she used to take me almost under her wing when I go there. She was so caring. I came to realize, on top of hospitality and generosity, I came to realize that every time it was a costly thing for her, the person was going to come. And she wanted to have something a little bit sincere because, you know, it was a pretty hard day. We were in the Confederation 4 years, and I'll tell you, there were some mean times. And I remember her generosity. But I also remember something else. My first trip there, I think it was either 5 or 6 babies to be baptized. And the first one was only just a few weeks old. But the last one, you went for 3 years, you were 3 years old. Well, you're such a size. I didn't. I got the father of the whole remote of harm. I was afraid I would have that. But what I remember about all this thing was a learning time for me. That after the service, one of the youngest ones started to cry. Well, then another one started to cry, joined in, and as they started to cry, I started crying. I started to get a little louder and a little louder. And by the way, they were almost all crying. And that was the way we could, sir. So, end of the service, I was down to whisper. I lost my voice. I learned the hard way. For future years, when you got a crowd in with them, you got some little ones there, don't try to beat them. Just do your thing. Because the Lord will hear you. That's the important thing about it. He hears you. The prayer ran the prayer book, the power works. Oh my. I got one that was a personal nature of that. I hope you understand it. But I used to have a draw in those days, a cigarette. And I didn't think it was a terrible thing to grow. And of course, we didn't know that sin, that we didn't know then, honestly. We didn't know that smoke was bad for your health or anything but that. Everybody smoked. So I had to prove what I went to Vanner and got, as soon as I got the first paycheck. I was 15 years and 9 months old. I went to work in Vanner. In fact, the van would come down for 10 cents a pack. You could buy the American cigarettes to the guys on duty at the gun in places around there. Well, I had to prove to the boys I was as good as they were. They were driving a van too. It was good, but, so I was spoken. I never had it. So I apparently made the first trip to George's Cove. I was seen going down the road at a draw. So the next time I went back there, someone said, "You know, sir, the Pentecostal preacher preached about you and what a terrible sinful man you are." So I took my cigarettes, I threw them away, and I drank my cigarettes. So he might have gone to his reward by this time. And I thank him for it. I'm serious, I thank the good Lord. You know, I might have given up for the wrong reason, I don't know. Probably did the same. But I'm glad I gave it up. It's very happy. Oh, well, that's another story. what page do you want to go on now? That Keith will be telling me about it. So I almost finished the game. I have that first year I had that open board, I didn't know where to go. Even though I grew up in a little village called Cardboy, it was called, as a fishing community, whatever. My father didn't like that, even the woodsman. And I used to love to go out the boat, go on Conway in the harbor. And I was ferries in summertime, in the cold, getting and skimming it in the water, all those things. but I didn't know anything about the boat. And I learned some of it that hard way. You know, I know one time I knocked all over and hit a bird, I run into Fox Harbor, drive her ashore so I could save her. and then put some putty in that dinner, and I got back that harbor. He was at risk of all, but I don't know. But I got lost in the fog sometimes. And from in the spring of the year, I came from just across to the Poise, over the Kitchen Shells, and in foggy, didn't have a compass with me. And I couldn't see coming through the tickle here. I couldn't see the tickle from fog. So I was a boy, some kind of net of that, and then tied it on, wait for sun to burn off, and got into a pickle. So I did lots of things, boys, people said. I had one serious experience, and that was, I was again in the open boat, and I was down the shore, and that might have meant it for my last extra visit, and get anxious to get home. And I left Williams Harbor, and I was coming into the Chubbs's, the stair of the side of the stair point for the night. That was the plan, and I did. But I could see there was a storm coming. That was evident. And that night the storm hit, like an old timer. and it was unreal. I think it's famous on this coast that there's a stormy place at the point, that's Spear Point, isn't it? So our Easter's and so on. So, well, that's all right. So, and there's only myself and two men did ladder. And he used to tell me one time, I mean, in his bedroom next to, I had a bedroom, and he had this homemade mattress, the oiler down, you know, just deep, and it was warm. But you see, after you spend like 2 or 3 hours, you wake up, and you're almost on the beer boat, and you come up around, and almost hold you. The old man's to worry about me. And the caller by name, do you think the parish is cold? And she said, no job. And boy, do you think the parish is cold? No job. And then we'd go 3 or 4 times. He'd be worried, but parish would be cold and pissed. But now, this had nothing to do with it. See, I guess. So then, anyway, next day you start, or you couldn't look at it. Whoa, and the third morning, I went for 2 days there, just sitting around there, you know, what do? And I felt the need of a bath and all, cleaned up and so on, but the next morning, that second evening, the wind died back, and it got stuck, you know. But the next morning, I got up, the sun is shining, so I walked down a big grassy field he had. Oh, I said, well, you can go home now. So I turned around, going to go back, and it was almost like he could read my mind. He was coming towards me, and I said, Skipper, going good for home now. Oh, no, Parson, you can't do it. It's too dangerous. Really too dangerous. Well, there's where, you know, there was my stupidity and ignorance. I wouldn't listen. And he was too kind. He wouldn't argue with it. It wasn't the thing to do. To argue, even though he was a young whippersnapper, by comparison, he wouldn't argue with a clergyman round Colorado. I tell you, sir, I'll go around the point. And if it's too bad, I'll come back. And very crunchy, well, okay, sir. I found afterwards he was out on the land watching like I got out of sight. I'm here, so you know I made it. But I went out, and I just had got outside point. I just got out in it. And my God, the waves, they're breaking all around me everywhere. And I'll go a little bit farther, maybe get better. But as I went farther, the same were getting better, it got worse. And I reached a point, well, I got frightened, you know, got nervous. And I said, oh, I think I'll go back. But then I realized, I didn't know how to go back. I didn't know, with the way they were bursting and all foundering, I was afraid if I turned broadside and they piled aboard me, I was going to lose my boat, and lost the boat, I'd lose Jim. That's no joke. So I said, well, I got to run aboard, I got to keep going. So I had to go a bit farther, and I get going. Well, and I didn't know that I should have slowed back the engine. I had to go full speed. I'd be on the wave, and it would pass it by, and I would go down, down, down. I thought I'd be sucked down in the bombed ocean. It was frightening. But I could manage that. But I've seen them behind me, and they were founder, whatever you call it. Well, one founder aboard the boat, that'd be in a minute. And one founder aboard the boat. And slammed me up and hit my little engine house. And the engine steer, because she was gas, what do you call it, motor with sparkles, and she started to tiss and miss, and there was the water, so I started to pump, and I pumped some water, pumped it out. And that's where I said, oh my God, no one come down now. And you know, my father, the last thing I did the day before I went to come down here, I was part of burying my father, who drowned at the Mummer Woods in January of that year. So I said, my God, what have I found after your father? They killed him, mother. And I started praying. Not a mess, on a serious note, I prayed. And I don't mind telling you, the first prayer was, I said, a prayer of confession. I confessed my ignorance and my pride and my lack of, you know, consent the common sense that I didn't listen to the wisdom of that old man. I asked God to forgive me. And I prayed he helped me. But then I made another prayer. It came out of me. I knew that you should pray that ultimately my will be done. And on some or other, it wasn't a formal prayer. I ended up by saying, Father, it's in your hands. Your will be done. And I'll tell you, my friends, that this confession I'm making, I guess, I don't talk about it, but it's a special time. And I believe something happened. Something came over me. And I felt at peace with the world. I felt a sense of peace. And I felt somehow God was with me. And I was doing His work. And I was doing what He wanted me to do. And running it like Julian Norwich in the 13th century. All will be well. But all will be well. And it was. And I went home. And I never went back. I did foolish things afterwards. I went ashore, coming down from Light Bay one time, rocks, and I'm waiting for the tide to run around the road. But I never had that experience afterwards. I didn't stop it. I tried to use some common sense, but I was never good at it. But all I know, I wasn't reaffirmed, you know, somebody, one of the things in my life, and lasting on my life, started here and now. And this place has always had such a warm place in my life. And I don't mind telling you, when I went to see the bishop a couple of days before the day after, we all had to go over sevens, I think, before many days. And in those days, there was lots of those in ministry, young people. And we were all asked, where's the bishop going to send us, I wonder? And I knew there was two or three vacancies in St. John's, was going to make curacies. And I was praying to death I was going to have it in the city. I didn't feel capable of a city ministry. I hated that. And I knew this place was vacant. And I said, too much open for the city way, waiting the crowd. I mean, I could see this far away. I could be happy down here in little communities like I came from. And when we look at Bishop Abraham, 6'6", sitting there, ornery glasses, looked at me over his glasses. Please, you ready for that ladder? Yes, my lord. I was having a laugh. Yeah, and I never ceased to thank God for put that in Bishop Abraham's mind to say, Jim made the battle hour. I learned so much, and faith gained so much. It's been with me all my life. Now, I think I would say, I haven't bothered to look at me much because I knew who was going to say it anyway. He told me for 10 minutes. I think you folks could do that long and buy a cup of tea and dinner. Now, I'm supposed to talk about rededication. And I'll be sensible. I won't talk about it. I'll make one brief scripture reference. There's a writing from the book of Joshua. It's an alternative reading for today, as a matter of fact. It's very brief, and it's a story. Joshua, they've had 40 years roaming around the Amorites, the Israelites, the Perizzites, all them, you know, Middle East days. They fought for 40 years after they passed the river, crossed the river, the river Jordan, the Red Sea, the river, and before they established themselves in Judea. And in those years, there was it start being a marriage, the gods, the Amorites, etc., etc. It was falling away. We all know what people fall away in church. You probably experience something yourself, Claudia. That's the old man is. And I bet that falling so I don't relate. And so that he challenged them. And he says, you call them together, you have to choose this day whom you will serve. The gods of the Amorites, the Perizzites, etc., or the God of Judea, the God who brought you to here from the land of Egypt. And he ends by saying, I know who I will serve. Me and my household, we will serve the Lord. And they responded, We too will serve the Lord. So that's all I want to leave you, my children. There's enough there for you to think about for the rest of your day. Every week, serving the Lord. Because that's what you people who live here have inherited. Maybe you were visitors, but you're back up. You didn't become what you are without all those people, good people, who had a quality of life. They lived, you know, generosity, you know, life spirit, kindness, caring, people doing things. No worry about it. No sense of personal cause. What I got is yours. We will share it together. And that's what you inherit, the way of life. Now we're coming at a time, it's a changing world. I'm aware of it, my own family, it's not like it used to be. You preach all you like is what you got to do. You hope you sow seeds with those around you. And some will catch. I have no doubt about that. You sow seeds. And we hope we're sowing the kind of seeds of those things that made us what we are. So that another 40 or 50 years from now, your children, grandchildren, whatever, will be here at St. James's Church and saying, thank God for those of the past for what they did and served you, God, and helped us become what we are. And that's all I want to say to you. May God bless you all. Thank you for your kindness. Thank you for listening. And may you have a wonderful day today.